Yes.
Okay, good. And my voice is loud and clear.
Yeah.
Super. Okay. So I request all participants to unmute so that we don't have a background noise when we are going through the course. And I would request that whatever questions you have, you can just type also in the chat, and later on we will try to take that questions later on. So the flow of the discussion and this technical training will be on the way. So again, thank you very much to all participants joined from worldwide. And let me start this training course on the significance of generator circuit breaker, which is mainly used in power plant. This is mainly not a part of a transmission or distribution substation. This application is mainly in power plants. So my name is Ketan Shah. I work with GCB factory in Switzerland. And as sir mentioned, I am almost like now going to finish 21 year now in ABB. Now we have Hitachi ABB Power Grid. So today in this training, we are going to cover circuit breakers in a power plant. What is the basic theory of short circuit fault in the power plants, and why generator circuit breaker are important in power plant, and what is the difference between HV circuit breaker, what you have in a substation, and a generator circuit breaker, and risk of using HV circuit breaker for power plant synchronization. So whenever you heard about a generator circuit breaker, the first thing come into mind, yes, it is related to the generator for sure. So the breaker which is connected to the generator, it's called a generator circuit breaker. The physical location of this breaker is between generator and generator transformer. Sometime, you know, some customers also have a definition to call this breaker as a generator circuit breaker, but there could be a terminology which can be used locally by any customer, but globally the name of generator circuit breaker implies to this equipment, because there is a global standard also for this product, which I will cover on the later on part. So GCB is the breaker which is situated or located between generator and a generator transformer. And when you look at physically in the layout, let's say this is your generator, whether it is thermal or a hydro or whatever power plant, and here you have your generator transformer. So this equipment is connected between generator and generator transformer, either this connection through IPB or NSPBD or cable, whatever connection could be. But this is the breaker which is between generator and generator transformer. And as I mentioned, the application of this breaker is in all power plant, whether it's a coal, nuclear, oil and gas, hydro, pump storage, biomass, geothermal, or latest application is also on a synchronous compensators, where now there are a lot of discussions going on to implement synchronous compensator to improve the grid stability. And these breakers are also connected to the synchronous compensators or a synchronous generator. Physically, this breaker look like this. Whenever you think about the breaker, you always think about, oh, it's some kind of porcelain or a polymer insulator where breaker is connected. No, these breakers are like an enclosure type of design. This is how this physically breaker look like. From one side, it is coming from generator. Another side is going to the generator transformer. And this is, let's say, phase one, phase two, and phase three, however you nomenclature, IRYB or ABC, UVW. So these are the three poles of the breaker along with the control cabinet. So this is how physically this breaker look like. Now let me go into the much technical aspects of this breaker. Why you need a GCB in a power plant? There is a vast topic on the economic consideration, which is beyond this time zone of the discussion what we have. But today I'm going to put more emphasis on the technical aspects of this breaker. The major four technical aspects why GCB are required for improved protection of power plant is to protect the costliest items, two costliest items in the power plant. One is generator transformer and another is a generator. So this is like an, you know, your insurance. We all are good driver, we all are healthy, but still we have our medical insurance and we still have our automobile insurance, because if some kind of failure or accidents happen to us, we are protected. And that's why we always have a protection system in entire system, whether it's a substation or anything. So this is like an insurance, and insurance is for your two critical items, generator and generator transformer. So major application of this, let's say if I put in a four pillars, this would be preventing a transformer tank from any internal fault. thermal and dynamic stress caused by the generator by, you know, synchronizing due to out of phase conditions, mechanical destruction due to the generator motoring, and protect the system due to the unbalanced load conditions. Now let me go one by one on all these technical aspects. First, we start with busting of a transformer tank following an internal fault in the main or unit transformer. So let's say if I start in a basic way, let's say when we talk about a generator and when we are connected that with a generator transformer, here we have our normal HV breaker, which is either a 400 kV or a 220 kV, depends upon the kind of power plant rating. Now, whenever we talk about the generator, here in generator, we always have two major items, which one is called a stator winding, from where EMF is induced always. And then we have a rotor. Rotor have its own winding, and rotor is also connected to a prime mover, which could be any kind of turbine. So let's say how electricity is generated in a stator. First, we are feeding a DC power to the excitation system. So this is called an excitation system, which could also have an excitation transformer and other topics. So excitation system or a DC fed to the rotor. So magnetic field is induced here, but it is not rotating because you are feeding a DC power. But as it is connected to a turbine or any kind of prime mover, this rotor is rotating. That means magnetic field is also rotating. And when this magnetic field come into the contact with a conductor, which is in the stator, EMF is induced. So this is a basic electrical principle of any generator. Now, this is most important to understand the application of the GCB. Now, what happens when there is a fault somewhere here? If there is a fault in a generator, your differential protection works. And differential protection trip this breaker. And similarly, at this time, it's also give a command for a generator to trip. Now, when you give a tripping command to the generator in such a situation, what exactly happened is task number one, you are going to de-excite your excitation system. That means you are closing the field breaker of the excitation system. But here, normally in the excitation system, we always have a static rectifier system, some diodes, MOSFETs, JESFETs, and all other electronic stuff. So it's going to be de-excited. It's not going to be like a sudden switch off. It's going to be de-excited. So excitation system will be de-excited. And you are also closing your governor, or if a hydropower plant, you are closing the valve with its the thermal or a steam turbine, then you are reducing the speed of the prime mover. But it is still rotating. This is still rotating because it slowly come down to its resting position. And this excitation system have its own de-excitation time. So whenever you have excitation system, it's have a de-excitation time, which doesn't come to zero. So what happened, even with a very sophisticated rectifiers, you have a de-excitation time, even let's say 8 seconds. That means even when you cut off the generator, there is a still induced EMF in the rotor, because your entire excitation system doesn't die at that time. And your prime mover is still rotating. That means this EMF, this rotating field, even with the low intensity, is creating a kind of magnetic field or induced EMF still in the rotor, and fault current is still flowing from a generator. So whenever there is a fault in a transformer, for some amount of time, there is a fault current which is always flow from generator. This is induced EMF principle, very basic to understand. Now, if I put this case into, let's say, in a diagram, let's say this is my generator, which is rotating. I have a transformer and it is connected to the grid. And now I have some kind of internal fault into the generator. So whenever we have a fault in the generator, from this side, let's say from a system side, fault current is entering from here. And from generator side, fault is also entering from here. The intensity of this fault, or characteristic of this fault and characteristic of this fault, is also totally different, because this fault current is mainly governed by the impedance or time constant of the machine, where here the fault current which is coming from here is also depends upon the system impedance and time constant of the impedances. So first, IS and IG is flowing from a both direction. Now, as you have a high voltage breaker on other side, this current will be terminated or it's cleared. But still, due to this induced EMF, what we have discussed so far, the fault current is still flowing from a generator. and then it's still flowing, and there could be a possibility a transformer could be also damaged. So this is the basic principle which goes along with a power plant. Now, what happened with a GCB in this case is, whenever you, like say you have a fault here, fault current is flowing from a both directions. We have tripped on the high voltage side, and now we are also going to trip the breaker between generator and generator transformer. So fault current, which is flowing from generator, is also getting now terminated. So the transformer is getting protected. This is how exactly a basic principle of this equipment work. This is very, very, very easy to understand. Like say, whenever you also talk about a, let's say 400 by 220 kV substation of yours, why you have a breaker on the both side? Because you wanted to protect this transformer from the fault current entering from a both side. Similarly way, when you talk about a generator transformer, it's very easy to understand why you have a breaker on the both side. Yes, you are going to trip this one. One can say, yeah, we are tripping the generator, so there will be no fault current. But it will be no fault current after what time? Because of this induced EMF, current will still flow. And then second question comes that, okay, but how much time it can take? We all know that even 1 second is sufficient to damage the transformer. So let's say, even though you have at one instant, you have an earth fault inside the HV transformer, how much time it will take? 100 milliseconds to convert into the three-phase fault. There are a lot of failure reports also published by authorities that how much time it takes to convert single-phase fault to the three-phase fault. So if such situation arises, generator transformer may also get damaged. And that means it's a huge loss of the revenue. And there are a lot of international paper published on this generator transformer failure. You can also Google it out. These are also available. Some are on the chargeable basis. But yes, this paper are also available globally. You can also went through this. And there is a clear risk analysis and a failure analysis of especially generator transformer failure has been discussed. The second most important thing which comes into the topic of the generator circuit breaker is synchronization of the power plant. It's very basic to understand. Yes, power plant has to be synchronized with the grid. Now, whenever we synchronized grid with a generator, we always check three parameters. We check voltage, we check frequency, we check phase angles. Now, if either of these things is not matching, or there is a mismatch due to any causes, like, you know, if during the commissioning somebody changed the wires, which is very, very obvious. I was a commissioning engineer at the power plant, so I know during the pre-commissioning check, we always keep changing the VT parameters. So this is the one thing which could happen. Delay during the HV breaker opening. Most of the time when we see in the context of the India, the breaker what we have seen here is mainly either a 400 kV breakers or a 220 kV breakers. And mainly these breakers are operated from three different drives. There is no single drive for that. Even at the 400 kV, I think it would be too difficult to have a single drive for all the three poles. So there could be a delay in HV circuit breaker opening. This can also cause sometimes failure during the synchronization. If there is a flashover also during this closing, then there could be also a synchronization failure. So if you have a situation where your synchronization fails, during this time, fault current, which is coming from a generator, it is called out of phase fault. It is described out of phase. That means your two phases are not synchronized, which is on generator side and another is on the grid side. And due to this, the out of phase condition, the out of phase fault, which is flowing from a generator, it is much, much severe. Like say, whenever you have a fault which is coming from a grid and the fault current which are coming from a generator, both have a different characteristics altogether, because generator have a different impedance characteristic, time constant characteristic compared to your system side. So whenever the fault current are coming from a generator, this is a typical waveform of the fault current which is coming. And now if you observed here, this waveform is a very unique because it's missing the zero, which is in electrical phenomena called a delayed current zero phenomena. Over all the high voltage breaker or a medium voltage breaker, or if you talk about the MCB which you are connected in a house, they are tuned or they are designed to clear the fault near the zero. Whenever sinusoidal wave comes close to the zero, we are clearing the fault. High voltage breaker are tuned to clear that kind of fault. But here, zeros are not coming. So these fault are very, very dangerous where zeros are not coming. And then there is a question, okay, how do I measure the delayed current zero? So there is a definition called degree of asymmetry, which is the ratio of a DC current versus AC current. Like whenever you have a component, whenever there is a fault current which is flowing, it have its DC component and it have an AC component. So whenever DC component is higher than the AC component, the ratio A is always higher than 100%. That means fault current, whenever it's coming from a generator, it's have a delayed current zero. That means degree of asymmetry is higher than 100%. And this fault current are much, much dangerous. And GCBs are main task of the GCB is to clear such type of fault. And that is how the standard of GCB has been drafted. The breaker which are here, they are not type tested to clear delayed current zero phenomena, which I will come to the later part when we talk about the difference between high voltage breaker and the GCB. So GCBs are very much important, and the prime duty of the GCB is to synchronize your generator with the grid. And that's the reason GCBs are type tested to clear such kind of fault. So when I come to the topic that improper frequency, improper phase angle, and improper voltage magnitude, in all these cases, what happened that due to this amplitude change or due to this value change, let's put in a case that one side you have a higher frequency and other side you have a lower frequency. So what exactly happened? Whenever you have a higher frequency, it can create a higher torque and try to pull the system into the generator side. So this can cause a turbulence on the generator side, and generator might got damaged also. And whenever you have an improper phase angle, in addition to this torque, what we talk about, this improper phase angle, when it's matched with the power system network, there will be also resultant transient voltage at an instant, which also damage the insulation of the equipment. I will also come down to some kind of transient failure of one of the transformer in India, which also have such effect. So poor phase matching during the synchronization, also called high transient torque, which can also damage generator or generator transformer also, because this sudden jerk is so high that it can also, this TR, we can also fail the insulations. And similarly, things happen when there is a voltage magnitude difference. And there are a few CEA reports are also there that, breakers are also failed during the synchronization, or transformer also failed during this synchronization process. And whenever you have such a situation, this is what happened to your generator and generator transformers. Now, third important thing which also comes into play in a power plant is a motoring effect. Now, what is a motoring effect in the power plant? So let's say you have a generator, you have a transformer, and you have an HV breaker. So whenever you don't have a generator circuit breaker between this, most of your operation was carried away or will be done by this breaker. Now, what exactly happened? Let's say you are... this is like an hydropower plant. You are running your hydropower plant. You get nodal guide agency. Okay, now you have to open the breaker. So what you do? You try to open this one. And yes, you have a three drives here. So let's say there is a situation arise that one of the breaker pole is not functioning or it have an internal breakdown. So one pole is having some kind of problem. It's either creating some kind of heavy arc or it's block. And this is very obvious with a high voltage breaker where you have three separate drives. So what happened during this condition, that if I put in time axis versus the speed axis, this is a critical rotor speed of generator and turbine. And now my HV breaker is having an opening command. So it's try to open. If it is open normally, this is my normal rundown, that my machine will slowly come to the zero speed and matter is closed. But let's say if one of the pole is having a problem, So what exactly generator understand? Oh, now I have to start because one phase is still close. So suddenly the speed will pick up. So gradually it's going down, but it suddenly try to accelerate. This is called a motoring effect. And due to this, vibration cause onto the generator. Every time it could not fail, but it can damage the rotor for sure. So if there are these vibrations is huge, or inertia of machine is designed in such a way that it cannot handle such a jerk, then there could be a failure also in the turbine itself or generator itself. And entire mechanical destruction can happen because it's deaccelerating, but it again accelerate. So this is the called a motoring effect. Sometimes it is, you know, it normally happens in the power plant, but customer doesn't aware, oh, this kind of situation always happens from my high voltage breaker side. No, it cannot happen. But yes, that's a fact. It can also happen due to some unbalanced situation or one phase issue at the high voltage breaker side. And the last one is unbalanced load conditions. What happened also, like, okay, first of all, what is unbalanced load conditions? Unbalanced load conditions are such phenomena which create the balance situation. And in the balance situation, we understand all the three phases are acting perfectly. So what are the examples of unbalanced load conditions? Is one of the phase does not close of the breaker, or one of the phase does not open on the high voltage breaker side, or there could be a single phase to earth fault at a transformer HV bushing, or there could be a two phase fault into the transformer, or there could be a two phase fault at LV terminal of the transformer. So these are the examples of unbalanced load conditions which can happen in the generator, transformer, and on the high voltage breaker side. Now, due to this, what exactly happened to the generator? Let's say due to this short time unbalanced load conditions, normally our systems are designed to operate under the balanced load conditions, as I said before. So during this unbalanced load conditions, generator winding produces a magnetic flux in the air gap between rotor and the stator. And this air gap also rotate at a synchronous speed. So what happened when this additional magnetic field is created between the gap of the stator and the rotor, this rotating magnetic field create some kind of current into the outer surface of the rotor, and because of the eddy current effect or a skin effect, is just flowing on the outer surface of the rotor, and it creates some kind of let's say current onto the outer surface of the rotor. And this current can also create a heat, and there are various cases what we have observed that stator and rotor jam. Even this doesn't happen, then there are a lot of cases which we have heard from a customer there that rotor outer surface is getting heated up, and frequently the rotor has to go for the maintenance. So this is an effect due to unbalanced load conditions. And if such unbalanced load conditions happen, then what happens is your fault current is now flowing from generator, and it can damage everything. So this is also unbalanced load condition. Whenever you have unbalanced load conditions, you have to protect your generator and generator transformer. And how one can do it with HV breaker, you can't clear such type of fault. As I mentioned, whenever there is a fault current flowing from a generator, you always have a delayed current zero. And delayed current zero are very, very severe. And this has some photographs which, you know, fundamental of unbalanced load condition effect. Okay, so we have heard all this, you know, topic of unbalanced load condition, short circuit and everything. So now let me go more into the detail about what is a short circuit fault theory. We always heard short circuit, but what exactly this short circuit or a fault theory means. So let's assume a case, or let's see a simple example. Here is my current axis, here is my voltage axis, and my breaker contacts are closed. Now there is a fault. So what happened in the fault situation? Current transformer is sensing a fault, secondary current change. It is also giving a sense to relay. Relay already sensed the fault, and now tripping command is going to the breaker. So during this fault conditions, my voltage becomes zero and my current is picked up. This is the fault current which is flowing, and during this instant, the arcing contact starting getting separated. Now, whenever there is a fault current flowing, you always have a symmetrical component of the fault current, which is, we say, AC component. You have a DC component, and the ratio of DC current versus AC current is called the degree of asymmetry, and this is the final asymmetrical current which is flowing into the system. Now breaker is start, this contact is getting started, separated, opening of breaker has been started. There is a small voltage developed between the contacts also. Now at one instant, breaker is trying to clear the fault. At this instant, breaker has to clear the fault when it's come very close to the zero, as we discussed. So this is the instance where breaker is going to clear the fault. So whenever you define a breaker, like a 50 kiloampere breaker or a 60 kiloampere breaker, we are talking about this instant. At this instant, breaker is going to clear the fault. So breaker is now clearing a fault. And after this instant, there will be no fault current which is flowing. But suddenly after this instant, when current becomes zero, the gap here is filled with an insulation. Either it could be SF6 or a vacuum or oil or air pressure based on the type of breaker. Let's assume it's an SF6 because we are, let's say, generally the popular breakers are SF6 breakers. So here it's filled with the SF6 gas, dielectric filled with the SF6 gas. And now the theory comes, rate of rise of restriking voltage. Now at this instant, there is a sudden voltage rise. Now due to this voltage rise, if the gap between this is not sufficient or the dielectric strength of this insulation is not sufficient here, arc will be restrike or fault is again restrike. So this gap has to handle this voltage peak, and this is called a transient recovery voltage. How fast the gap or how fast here the voltage is developed. This is maximum peak value which is reached, and how much in microsecond it's reached. Breaker has to handle such a TRV. If breaker cannot handle such TRV, then there is again fault current which is flowing. So basic theory of the short circuit, whether it's a high voltage breaker or a medium voltage breaker or any short off breaker. This is the basic theory. First, you have a fault. At one point, you are clearing a fault. Whenever fault current is flowing, you have an AC component, you have a DC component, you have a degree of asymmetry. After the fault is clear, there is a TRV or rate of rise of restriking voltage, and TRV measured in a kV per microsecond. So this is basic principle of any breaker or any fault. Now, after you clear the fault, everything become normal. But now let's go to a basic into the more definitions of this operating time. You have an initiation of short circuit. And now breaker is getting a trip command and the energization of trip circuit start. This is called a tripping delay or a relay time, which could be in the range of, let's say, 10 milliseconds. And now breaker contact is started operating, and at one instant breaker is open. So this is called opening time of the breaker, and put together opening time plus tripping delay put together is called your contact parting time. So whenever you define the rating of the breaker, you are defining the rating of the breaker at this instant. And after this, there will be an arcing inside the contacts. And this is instant where after this arcing is stopped and current is fully interrupted. So the opening time plus arcing time put together is called breaking time of the breaker or interrupting time of the breaker, which you say 40 millisecond or a 50 millisecond. Or a 60 millisecond. So these are the timing definition of the breaker. So what is clear here is that whenever you are defining the breaker, you are defining the breaker at this interval, at contact parting time, whether you say 50 kiloampere breaker or a 60 kiloampere breaker. And breaker has to clear DC component and AC component at this instant. So this is the basic fault theory goes for any kind of breaker. And now when we come to the fault, which is coming from a system, and the fault current, which is coming from a generator. So as I mentioned, we have an AC component, we have a DC component, and a final asymmetrical current, which is flowing. This is like say vector sum of AC plus DC. And now if you see the basic two curves, the difference between this one and this one, here you are still having a zeros, but here you don't have a zeros. So out of phase fault, and a fault current which are coming from generator, these are having a delayed current zero phenomena. And that's why this fault current are more dangerous. And whenever you have such a situation, your degree of asymmetry is more than 100%. Or sometime you also define DC constant. You say, okay, my DC fault is very high. If you talk about I have seen also such a some specifications also from few customers in India. They say, oh, I want DC component very, very high for the breakers which are connected to the generator. This is what exactly this topic is all about. And I have also seen few specifications which demands in India gang breaker at HV side, that they just want one operating drive on the high voltage side, because they think that, okay, synchronization can fail also. So these are the major reasons, I will say, or I will put in this way. Actually, high voltage breakers are not has to perform such kind of duties, but you force them to perform such kind of duties. So again, come to the basic of this fault current. As I mentioned, let's say this is the fault current which is flowing. This is the peak withstand voltage which breaker has to handle. And at this instant, you are going to separate the contact or contact parting time. At this instant, you have this DC component, and here you have this AC component. And the degree of asymmetry of this fault current is ratio of DC current versus AC current. And the total asymmetrical current which is flowing, this is how it's getting calculated. So whenever you calculate the fault current, irrespective whether from system or from a generator side, you have to see what is the degree of asymmetry or what is your DC component. Now, I also like to take here NHPC specification, which is, you know, the NHPC is also developing so many power plant also in India. The one of the important clause which we also come across in one of the tender, which I don't know whether this project, what is the status, but it's called Tista Stage 4. And here what is written in the specification, that generators are capable of 180 degree and 120 degree phase synchronization magnetic unbalance at rated speed with a 50% pole short circuit state. So this is exactly what we are also talking about, and NHPC is also talking about that. So that during this out of phase fault, two phase can be go 180 degree out of phase. When you talk about two phases, what is the maximum angle they can differ? They can differ at 180 degree. So this is what also NHPC also is requesting for, that whenever you have a fault during the synchronization, this out of phase fault can occur. And if you have an out of phase fault occur, and if you don't have a GCB installed somewhere here, this breaker has to clear such kind of fault, 180 degree or 120 degree out of phase fault. And this HV breaker in a substation need to clear such kind of fault, which is coming from a generator, fault current coming from a generator. And then question come, oh, how to calculate such kind of fault current, or what is this 120 degree or 180 degree out of phase fault current, or what is the standard of HV breaker says? Because there is always standard. Okay, whatever I say, okay, can work, but what is written in the standard? What is important that is written in the standard? So let's discuss on this topic. So as I said, you have an AC component, you have a DC component, you have a symmetrical fault. So whenever you have a fault during the synchronization, your fault current is coming from here. And as you see, there is a delayed current zero. And even in the lower frequency term, sometimes it depends upon the parameters of the generator. But how to calculate this? This is the formula how one can calculate out of phase fault current. And here you see in this formula, there are a lot of definitions goes. One is impedances of the machine, time constant of machine, and also moment of inertia of the machine. So all this parameter goes into the calculation of the fault current which is coming from generator. So even somebody, let's say there is a project from a BBMBA have 150 megawatt of machine from one supplier. And second, in their project, Satluj Jal Vidyut Nigam came and said, okay, we have a same machine, but we have a from the BHEL. So fault current will be the same. No, fault current will be different, because both the supplier have a different characteristic. Both the supplier's generator have a different parameters of the impedances and a time constant, and even in the moment of inertia. So every time, this fault current will change. Depends upon the manufacturer design. And this phase voltage, out of phase voltage, let's say whenever you have 180 degree out of phase, that means your voltage become twice. And that's the reason sometime also breaker fail even before during the synchronization. Like you are trying to do synchronization from here, and there is a 2 PU voltage develop here, and you are not able to close in some predefined time where these breakers are type tested. So insulation of this breaker also got failed sometimes. this is a very basic phenomena. I'm not talking about this phenomena. Even breaker have handle to a 2 PU, and after that, you are trying to close the breaker and synchronization fails. It is a worst condition which could have happened in the power plant, and the entire generator and generator transformer got damaged also. Breaker will not a big value, but this one is a big value. So this is how the out of phase current calculated and depends upon the angle, phase angle difference. The fault characteristic look like this. With 90 degree, your values are lower compared to 180 degree. But it has more severe, delayed zero current situation also. Even with 180 degree, TRV even become worse. Transient recovery voltage become worse because your fault current amplitude is also very high. So even with 90 degree, 120 degree or 100 degree, which is also, requested in NHPC specification, synchronization from HV breakers are also risky. And as I mentioned here, to clear such kind of fault, this breaker has to clear such type of fault with a delayed current zero. And then now question comes, what standard says? Can this breaker clear such type of fault? Now, this is the abstract from IEC 627-100, which is a specification or a standard for a high voltage breaker, not a GCB. This is for the high voltage breaker. And it is clearly mentioned also in this specification that when circuit breakers are in the vicinity of a center of a generation, the AC component may decrease more quickly than the normal case. That means DC component is high. And during this case, circuit breaker operation can be only guaranteed subject to careful investigation. So this is the basic topic, which is also, we would also like to highlight to participants that this is a very big risk when you are trying to synchronize power plant through high voltage breaker. Because even high voltage breaker standard says that if you are using your breaker, using high voltage breaker, which are tested with this duty, and you are using this in the vicinity of a generation, close vicinity of a generator, that means connected to the generators, then you have to do a careful investigation. And then we also have gone through various topics, but an important topic which I would like to highlight here, which also with the NHPC specification, that it's also written here that brake shall be normally applied automatically in the air. The breakers are not applied unless the wicket getter closed and GCB open. So everywhere, if you see, generator specification of NHPC is also defined GCB. Then generator transformer clauses is also defined that yes, you have to do the operations from a GCB side. And then when we go to the protection specification, it's also about asking about the GCB. Governor clause is also asking about the generator circuit breaker. Even excitation system is asking about the generator circuit breaker opening. So there are a lot of clauses in the NHPC. It's talk about GCB application. But when we talk about the situation with the NHPC, that what is the definition of GCB you think? They say, oh, we think GCB is a high voltage breaker side. So this is what I say. It depends upon customer to customer to which breaker you tell GCB. So what NHPC also thinks, which might be, NHPC treated as a guru of the hydropower plant, and whatever they say, that's also correct. So if they think that GCB is a high voltage side, but they say, oh, this breaker has to clear 180 degree and 120 degree out of phase faults, which is having a delayed current zero. Can HV breaker clear such fault? So that's a risk. And we have also went through the CEA guidelines recently, which also says that the generator cell also capable of withstanding maximum stress during the normal operation. And the same clause is also says 180 degree and 120 degree out of phase conditions. So this is what exactly NHPC is also requesting through CEA. And it's also said in a synchronization clause, you can go, this is regulation of 2019 of CEA guideline on the power generation, which also says that automatic as well as the manual facility along with the synchronization and guard relay facility of generator transformer and generator circuit breaker for synchronization of generator with the grid. So it's also mentioned that whenever you have to do a synchronization, it is done through a generator circuit breaker. Now again, question come, what is the definition of generator circuit breaker? Whether it's HV breaker or it's a breaker between generator and generator transformer. So this is what IEC says. IEC IEC IEEE 6227-37013. This is the standard for generator circuit breaker. This is not the standard for generator circuit breaker. And when you look at this standard, it is written generator circuit breaker installed between generator and step up transformer are not within scope of the standard. So break GCB standard is this one. High voltage breaker standard is this one. They are designed to perform synchronization, protect the generator transformer, not this breaker. So this is the basic difference between generator circuit breaker and a high voltage breaker. So this topic is not very well known also in India. This is what we also think through CBIP. We can highlight this to the important customers that whenever you go for the next time a power plant, this is the important thing which also plays a critical role. And by virtue of this, you can also understand what is a short circuit, a basic short circuit fault theory, what is a delayed current zero, why rotor also is getting damaged into the most of the power plant. And the most important thing when it's come to the economical aspects also, okay, this is a very big topic, but I just wanted to highlight a very few, only through one slide, I can try to highlight this. You have an EHV substation or maybe you have an HV substation also, and through HV substation in a power plant, somehow you feed your station transformer and through you are feeding your auxiliaries. But sometimes this could also be a same one, like, you know, maybe this will also through taken through a 400 kV or a 765 kV also. Sometimes we also seen power plant in India, which are also evacuating at 765 kV. So whenever you use, you have a power plant without GCB, you need additional station transformer and all other things. But whenever you are trying to go without GCB, you can eliminate at least one, or maybe sometime you can eliminate the entire thing also. So the entire one additional diameter station transformer is connection, everything you will be saved. So somebody thinks, okay, I'm adding an additional equipment in my power plant, but yes, you are also removing most of other items also from your power plant, and you are increasing the protection, safety and reliability of your power plant. So that's also some economic consideration of the GCB goes, which I will not try to cover here, being most this is a technical training. But yeah, this is the one aspect which some commercial guy can also take over. Huh? So this is what we have to say all about the generator circuit breakers. If I summarize, generator circuit breaker are very much important for power plant, mainly on the synchronization side. And also when you have to protect your generator or generator transformer from internal fault into the transformer, some unbalanced load condition. Yes, these are the all theories which goes with a generator circuit breaker. And I hope most of you like this technical session. So thank you very much for listening to us. And now I would like to take questions and answer from the participants. Yes, I can go to the conversation. Yes, any question from any participants?
Yes, I would like to ask. I am A.K. Rajput. Am I audible?
Hello, sir. Yes, sir, very much, sir.
Actually, this application of the generator circuit breaker with regard to the renewable energy sources, particularly yes, the wind turbines, as well as the solar power plants. In solar power plant, naturally there is no rotating part, so there it is not required. But in the biomass, in the biomass based plants and the wind turbine plants, there are rotating mass. So up to which capacity, from which capacity we should start using them? Say lower capacity of 500 kilowatt or 1 megawatt could be spared. And the wind turbine having capacity more than 1 megawatt to be equipped with the generator circuit breaker.
Okay, sir. What is the lower capacity of the generator which can be used with such an application is also subject to the grid stability study. Like if there are, let's say if you have an n numbers of turbine which is connected to the one node, short circuit behavior of that grid will also behave abnormally. So I would say rather than making some kind of rule, that okay, before or let's say this is the minimum megawatt, beyond this there should be a circuit breaker. One should study the proper single line diagram and scheme, and then some kind of rule could be implemented. But yeah, as far as general rule is concerned, when you have a standalone hydro, thermal or steam, I would say the lower capacity, what we have also seen in outside world, it's even with a 20 megawatt machine or 30 megawatt machine, people are putting generator circuit breaker. You see, whenever your small capacity of generator directly connected to the medium voltage switchgear, and your medium voltage switchgear breaker, if it is type tested with the standard which I have shown to you, they are acting like a generator circuit breaker. So even we have seen few cases also in India where small megawatt of machines are directly connected to the MV switchgear. Even I have seen such a application in even Bhutan. There is a power plant called Bosachu, yes, which is equipped with a small capacity, 40 kilo ampere generator circuit breaker. So answering to your question, sir, I would say there is, if in India you have to form some kind of guideline, maybe we can jointly discuss that after which megawatt with thermal, solar, hydro, what kind of rule has to be established. Because every power plant have its own characteristics.
And say in which conditions, and have to say generating unit supplying power to the nearest grid at which particular voltage level. Say either it is a 33 kV, 66 kV or 132 kV. That will also make a difference. So that need to be deliberated in a particular session.
Of course, sir. You invite, yeah, we can also do, you know, if you can also, we can also have a one-to-one conversation with your organization. You can send us your agenda of topic, and then we can deliberate via MS Teams or a separate invitation. And we can have a detailed discussion on that.
One more thing, sir. Lot of details and lot of things are being talked about this offshore wind turbines. So what is the practice in other parts of the country where the offshore wind turbines are there, and how they are using it?
I will share these details in a separate forum, sir, when we do a one-to-one conversation with you.
So in the chat I am giving, of course, many of your team members may be knowing me, but in the chat, yes, box, sir, I am giving my name and the email and phone number.
Oh, thank you very much, sir. Thank you. So yeah, I will contact you. Yeah.
Please be in touch.
Hello?
Yes,
sir. Am I audible?
Yes, sir, very much. Yeah,
this is Sabir Apte from Stelmec Ahmedabad.
Yes, sir.
When we are discussing the motor effect, when the generator tries to come back into synchronization due to the failure of one pole of the breaker, is it that just by having one phase in the on the, you know, still connected on the grid, it cannot create that momentum for the generator to come back, no?
It can create, because you know what generator also, if you look at the whole system, one phase is still, one phase is closed. That means it creating an unbalanced load conditions. So due to this unbalanced load conditions, machine will again try to accelerate.
No, but how the machine will sense? Because there should be some torque getting generated in the generator due to the system voltage from the grid. When one phase is kept hooked up, it is like single phasing of a motor, what we generally say. So in that case, the torque will not be sufficient. Single phase cannot generate that momentary, the rotating torque. It needs at least two phases so that some torque is generated.
So let's say whenever you try to open the breaker, your breaker is in closed condition. Now you are trying to open the breaker, not during the synchronization, let's say during the opening conditions. And yeah, your two phases are already clear, and the third phase is about to open, and there is a fault. But during this time, you are not giving closing command to the to your generator, right? And at the instant when you are giving a first command, or let's say at 0 second, you give a trip command, and at the same instant, you are also giving a governor or some kind of turbine tripping command. That turbine, you also go, you stop. But whenever there is a failure on the one side of the pole, there is also auto reclose on the breaker side. So it's again tried to close the breaker on the HV side. So in that fraction of amount, there is again a torque onto the motor. or I mean to say the set of a generator and the motor.
So because the point is, just one phase if it's connected, it will be like hooked up on the that system voltage. There will not be
I can resultant simulate,
voltage create the torque, isn't
I
it?
I can simulate the whole situation and give it to you in very much of detail in the real ETAP, what exactly happened.
Yeah, fine.
Yeah, there is a question also from Mr. Malan that 400 megawatt, what would be the approximate price of the GCB? I'm very sorry, I'm not that expert of telling you the prices right now. But yeah, you can send us the request and maybe we can discuss along with our team. And then second question, what are the reasons for utility not installing a GCB? Okay, there are various reasons why somebody don't install GCB, because maybe this topic is not known. Somehow it's also getting, you know, copy pasted from somewhere else. But I can tell you in India, there are customers who are using the GCBs. Like I will say 10 Jetco, Tamil Nadu, Telangana, Andhra Pradesh, Gujarat, they are using the GCBs. Even with a 600 megawatt and 800 megawatt, yeah, most of this customer, what I told you, yeah, they are having a GCBs. How many generator damage can be attributed to the lack of GCB? There is no certain, public data available, but in India, I can see there are CEA reports on that. Maybe you can also ask few of your colleagues also who are working in this field, because there are some reports which are in public, but some are the reports which are not in public. So on the public report, I would say there is a generator transformer failure also there in the CEA website, report failures, and also high voltage breaker failure reports are also there in the CEA website during the synchronization. And then there is a questions also from Mr. Rajguru. Do you have any white paper on short circuit current limitation for parallel generators? Okay, this is a different topics altogether, but what you wanted to really wanted to do with the parallel generator, fault situation during the parallel generators. If you have any particular case, share the detail with me. I can help you with the simulation, how exactly situation happened with the parallel generators. And then there is a question also from Mr. Yusuf, Malaysia. Similarly, due to the rotating nature of the motor, will it also be contribute fault current? Yes, sir, it is. Such kind of situation also happened in a pump storage power plant. Please share your email ID. I do, sir, I will share. And what is the expected value of a DC component should be cleared by GCB? It depends upon power plant to power plant. For every power plant, we need to conduct a study and then we calculate AC current and a DC current, and based on that, the DC component of the GCB will be calculated, and what is based on the type tested value of a GCB, GCB selection should be done. Thank you, Rajput sir, for sharing your details. I will be in touch with you.
Just one more question. Suppose yes, there is an existing power plant.
Yes, sir.
Hello.
Yes, sir. I'm listening, sir.
Is it possible to configure and establish this generating circuit breaker in the existing plants, existing units?
Yes, sir. Very much possible. Very much possible. If you recall the first slide, what I have shown to you, it just installed between generator and generator transformer in the run of the IPB. It doesn't take any additional space. So if you have to install, we have to dismantle this IPB, just put it inside and connect it up. We need to assess it, but I have not seen any power plant where such retrofitting cannot be done. So if you can share the details of photos of that, we can also assess that situation.
And this GCB is having SF6 or what?
There are both technologies available. If I put in this way, we as a Hitachi ABB Power Grid, General Electric, G, I think there are also a few colleagues in this meeting also from General Electric. They also manufacture generator circuit breaker. And Siemens is also manufacturing generator circuit breaker. So there are the three suppliers in the world available who manufacture generator circuit breaker. And the erstwhile company ABB, who is also having now vacuum circuit breaker. They also have a vacuum circuit breaker with them. And rating is available even from a lower side on the 40 kilo ampere, and higher side it can also go up to 300 kilo ampere also. There is a question from Mr. Singh. Do you have any study report about a DC component breaking capacity of generator circuit breaker? If any, share please. Sir, as I said, for each and every generator circuit breaker, it's having a different capacity, because generator circuit breaker are also defined based on their short circuit capability. It's ranging from 40 kilo ampere to 300 kilo ampere. So how exactly the application of the GCB goes into power plant is based on the power plant data. GCB manufacturer conduct a study, which always be a free of cost for supplier for sure. And based on that study, we calculate which breaker can clear such kind of fault, because we also have a various ratings. If you have any specific application of your power plant, please do share your contact details with me, and we can deliberate this topic in a much more details. There is also a question from Mr. Ghosh. I have a few questions about the GCB parameters. What is the maximum level of percentage DC component of a GCB? When you talk about the percentage DC component, and if I put a degree of asymmetry can be anything. So whenever you check about any breaker, you have to check about the AC component and the degree of asymmetry and asymmetrical component. There is a vast topic on this. Maybe in this forum, I cannot cover the whole thing. But yeah, every breaker have its own type tested value, and based on that, it has to be compared. And when it's come to the TRV levels, IC62273703, they define this kV per microsecond for all the breakers. Like if you have a transformer or a generator rating based on some MVA, they define how much kV per microsecond breaker has to handle. Opening and closing speed are also specific from product to product. If you have any project, we can discuss with you. First fault to clear factor is 1.5. Mostly GCBs are still SF6 or ACB. Air circuit breaker is, these are the old technology. Now, most recent breakers are SF6 breakers. Any possibility of having vacuum circuit breaker in the domain of the GCB? Yes, there are vacuum circuit breakers also by some manufacturers. Are there any advantage questions from Mr. Shiva? Are there any advantage and disadvantage between SF6 and vacuum? Yes, this is a very vast topic. Maybe in a separate forum, we can discuss this. But it has to be dealt with project to project. Ashok sir, reply, can we install GCB on an existing unit? Yes, we can. And please share your email ID and phone number. Yeah, after we finish this one, in this chat box, I will share my email ID and my phone number on a WhatsApp. You can contact me on a WhatsApp. And we can address any particular topic which you have for any your particular application. I think it's a very interesting questions, and I hope most of the participants is enlightened with this technical know-how. Any more question, please?
Yes.
Yes, please.
Yeah, I am Esther. I am a patra speaking from CA.
Hello, sir.
Yes, I just have some query regarding GCB. What is the duty cycle of the GCB and G1, G2 class GCB? What is the difference? Like C1, C2, you are M1, M2, and C1, C2. What is the classification in generator circuit breaker like that, and what is the duty cycle compared to conventional breakers?
Okay. Whenever we talk about a generator circuit breaker, have a two class of operating duty. One during the normal conditions or a load conditions, which is CO, 3 minutes CO. And whenever it coming about the fault current, it would be CO, 30 minutes CO, which is in line with the standard of a GCB, which is 62273703. And whenever we talk about this class of the fault current, especially on a generator fault current, there are two class recommended by a standard, which is called a G1 class of the breaker and a G2 class of breaker. Whenever you have to talk about the G1 class of the breaker, the fault current rating defined by generator, it would be with a degree of asymmetry with 110%. And if you talk about the G2 class of the breaker, they are having a degree of asymmetry about 130. So G1 class and G2 class, these are the two breakers defined. And there is also a guideline given in IEC 62737013 that for a given power plant, in loaded condition and unloaded conditions, in a lagging power factor on a leading power factor, how one can select a generator circuit breaker with a generator source fault current capability.
Can you explain this CO, 30 minute CO? What does it mean practically?
I don't have right now any presentation on that, but what I can do, if you can share your email ID, sir, I will send you more details on this on your email ID.
No, I'm just asking you, what is the basic concept behind this? Closing and opening, then 30 minutes gap. What is that the gap? What is the meaning of that 30 minute gap against your operation?
Okay. Let's say when you talk about the load condition, when, as I said, CO, 3 minute CO, that means after closing and opening operation, that has to be a 3 minute gap again to perform next CO operation.
Okay.
And similarly, when you talk about the fault condition, it's a 30 minute because this breaker are going to clear heavy duty fault. Like somewhere when you talk about 660 megawatt machine or 800 megawatt machine, the fault current are also going in the range of 200 kiloampere. So this breaker has to clear 200 kiloampere fault. So next fault current should not come in next 30 minutes. Otherwise, okay. Because breaker is heated up with you know, fault clearance of almost like a 200 kiloampere. So this is that timeline for or time gap between the duties.
Okay, that means the breaker should be suitable for next operation only after 30 minutes.
Exactly. And if somebody says, sir, you know, next 200 kiloampere will come in next 30 minutes, then the system is having some problem.
Yes, definitely there is problem. But that is the basic thing that we have to test the breaker for this condition only.
Absolutely, sir. Absolutely. Absolutely. You got it the point, right, sir?
Okay. Now basically, G1, G2 class is concerned to the symmetrical DC component, you mean to say?
Yes, sir. Yes, asymmetrical component. You have a delayed current zero phenomenon.
And like in a conventional breaker, you have C1, M1, C2, M2 like that. Is there anything like that in the GCB? Only G1, G2 or something else is there also?
No, mechanical endurance is also there for such breakers, like an M1, M2 category. Thanks for this question. You know, what happened with a generator circuit breaker is, generator circuit breaker are also very widely used in a pump storage power plant. And pump storage power plant also operate very frequently, like, you know, sometimes 2 times in a day or 3 times also in a day when they have to switch on to the motor generator. So the generator circuit breaker, which used also in a power plants, they are also type tested for 20,000 no load operations, 20,000 beyond M2 of HVU circuit breaker. So M1 and M2 also defined in a GCB standard, but here M1 and M2 are respectively 2,000 and 5,000 operations. But mostly what we know in the market, that even our the other manufacturers, like a GE and Siemens, their breakers are also type tested for more than 10,000 operations.
Okay, then how many short circuit currents it can withstand? Like suppose a 200 kiloampere breaker, DCB breaker, how many full short circuit current it can? Because all the time you may not expect 200 kiloampere. Sometimes it may be 10 kiloampere, sometimes it may be 100 kiloampere. All the time it may not have 200 kiloampere. So if a breaker is subjected to 200 kiloampere, how many such applications you can
support? Yeah, very good question, sir. So what happened, that, you know, in a breaker, either it could be done offline or it can also be done online on the GCB, that whenever breaker operates, as you rightly mentioned, sometimes it's also clear fault of 1 kiloampere, 2 kiloampere, 3 kiloampere, or various, even the load current also, they can break also. So there is online and offline, both systems are available. Based on the current which is cleared by the breaker, breaker can measure what is the wear of the contact, and it can also give you analysis to the users that what is the percentage of life remaining for the breaker. This would be done within the breaker analysis itself. It's called ablation of the breaker, and based upon the amount of the load current or the fault current which breaker can interrupt, this breaker itself calculate what is the life of the breaker is remaining. This is also somehow, I would say, an advancement or a digital thing which now also going into the GCB.
I mean to say, how many short circuits, so 2.5 on an average, like, you know, conventional breaker.
Short circuit. Okay, you can say 4. As an average, you can say 4, sir. Yeah.
Yeah. Then the contact healthiness monitoring, generally in a conventional breaker, you go for this dynamic contact resistance measurement. Okay, DCRM.
Yes.
So, in this case, what are the here to assess the condition of health of the contacts?
Yeah, both.
It has to pass through a very severe current or very, very high current, much more than a conventional breaker.
Yes. So, as I said, offline, it's same as DCRM. Breaker will be opened and then this DCRM test would be done. And then health of the contact breaker would be known. And based on the deviation from the defined value by the manufacturer, one can go for the overhauling of the contact of the breaker. This is an offline. And then online, as I said, every time this breaker operates, this built-in monitoring system of the breaker, they can monitor the health of the breaker. And in the monitoring system or a wave interface, it can give you a kind of information that what is the life of the breaker remaining, that after how many further operations breaker can do. So I can provide you much more detail on this topic, sir. This is a very big topic on generator circuit breaker monitoring.
Users must be going for this type of monitoring devices along with the supply.
Sir, it depends. If some customer asks, we always give. But this is optional. I will put in this way.
Is it very costly component or is it normal? Not very.
Compared to breaker, it's not so costly for sure. But it depends. You know, some customer have their own philosophy of working, and we operate worldwide, and then we have to take care of a lot of customers. So we kept it optional. But you are absolutely right, sir. Some intelligent customer always ask.
Now, what about the application of this GCV in our Indian system? Particularly hydro people, they are not very comfortable. I have insisted them to go for GCV, but they are not going for GCV, which has a lot of other advantages, that not taking the advantage of this GCV, because they are always saying we have underground stations, we cannot accommodate all these breakers in hydro station. Is it the fact or something else?
So you pointed out a very right question. Taruna ma'am is also there, who can also talk with the CA organization. But you are absolutely right, sir. Hydro doesn't have that application in India. But I would put in this way, there is no limitation of putting GCB in any hydropower plant. Even in India, I have also visited a few of the hydropower plants in India, even a small rating of even 25 megawatt. And also some big power plants also, like an 150 megawatt or 200 megawatt. And I can assure you, at most of the plant, GCB can be retrofitted for sure. And I would put in this way, most of the pump storage power plant in India, they are having a GCB. Most of the pump storage power plant, except the one which got fired, which got, you know, this catches this fire. I forgot the name of that power plant, which is in southern side. Which having this accident and the 9 people were dead. That pump storage power plant don't have a GCB. But all the power plant in India, one in Madhya Pradesh, one in Gujarat, I think two in Madhya Pradesh, Ghatgar, I forgot the second name, but one is a Ghatgar. There is also one in Gujarat, which is Sardar Sarovar. One which is in Tehri, which is also getting developed by GE. This all power plants in India, I see, even I will say pump storage power plant hydro only. Okay, so they are having a GCB. So I don't think so. It's a problem. Yeah, Shri Siya Salam, somebody typed it. Yeah, this is Shri Siya Salam. Shri Siya Salam is a hydro, but it doesn't have a GCB there.
What about thermal power plant?
Thermal power plant, sir, I have seen recently most of the power plant, as I mentioned, Tamil Nadu is having a GCB, 600 megawatt, 800 megawatt machines. North Chennai, Upur, which also getting by you know, General Electric is also supplying their GCBs, and in Andhra Pradesh,
NTPC has gone from 800 megawatt or not any 800 megawatt or 60 megawatt unit has any GCB.
Yes, sir. Initially there was a GCB very much introduced in NTPC, but recently what I have come across some discussions with NTPC colleagues. That they don't find it economical. Then we investigate that topic a bit, and then what we came to know that somehow they included type test charge of the GCB in their evaluation.
Okay.
Okay, so the manufacturer is hesitating to quote, you know, GCB type test standards because everyone is afraid to getting, you know, this type test reputation. And the GCB kind of thing is very small value, but type testing value is big to big.
Oh, okay, thank you. Thank you.
There is a question also.
Just a minute, AK Rajput here.
Yes, sir.
Just actually, all the pump storage plant having GCB. Maybe the reason that they are external based means they are the imported technology has been used. And maybe if existing one region goes or one saying says that maybe because of the economical reasons, the practice has not been followed in India. But the technical concept and the knowledge base may be there either through the consultant or through the in-house designs of the big organizations and the including the SCBs or the GenCos. So that may be one of the reasons that the GCB was not being practiced in India. Another is the availability itself of the GCB in India. And why is the GCB is there in the pump storage plant and not in the Sri Salem, maybe might have been missed because of the economic reasons. And in other pump storage plant, it is there because of the technology itself as a package. The whole package has been imported. That may be one of the reasons. Actually, case study has to come out. A case has to come out with solid ground that if you use the GCB in your installations, these are the net advantages, irrespective of, say, you are investing somewhat more in the beginning. So that type of the case study should come out. Of course, very nicely you have tried to tell some of the items, some of the things, technical aspects, that by having this type of the facility in the power generation installations, you are going to get certain advantages. That's all.
Yeah, I completely agree with you, sir, that the particular case study will really help. And through CBIP or CEA forum, we are very glad if some users come across and share the data, and we can jointly publish such papers also on that in India. If some utility come up with their details, then we are ready to collaborate on that topic. And on the economic side, I will put in this way, sir. You know, when somebody installed a new power plant, GCB will the rounding of error. GCB value will come in a rounding of error. It's such a small value, and with the use of GCB. One should easily eliminate this station transformer and the related GIS bay, all these cables which are going into the tunnel. So it's anyway, it's not going to adding any cost. But yeah, I completely agree with you that this has to be done with a case study and with the help of CBIP and CEA. If some users can come across with such details of the failure, and we can jointly publish such papers also, technical papers, so everybody would be enlightened.
For that, a detailed questionnaire should be floated to the concerned utilities, asking certain specific questions that why you are not using or why you have not opted for the use of the GCB. So that time they could give out of their practical experience that why they have not. So the reason may be most of the plants have been supplied in India by BHEL, and maybe it has not been their practice to use the GCB.
Agree, sir.
I think Ketan will take this up further with CBIP. This is really required because many users are really want to know why it is not very much in use or what are the disadvantages if we are not using. So we will take up this session maybe next week or so. We have Manas sir also from CBIP online right now. We have Mohapatra sir from CEA. So we will coordinate this. You and me together, we will coordinate this and try to see how we can work on this.
I take this
task.
Thank you, ma'am. The question is that what is the operating mechanism of GCB, gang operated or a single pole operated? It's a gang operated breaker, like a one pole for all the three drives. This is how GCB is also designed. And then there is also a question that closing a transmission line with a large angle difference could cause stress on the generator shaft, especially if the line is located close to the generator. What would be the typical maximum auto reclose angle setting, and how do we protect the generator from this phenomena? This question came from Mr. Faisal. I am not very clear whether you are talking about this scenario with GCB or without GCB. Like whenever you have some closing of line, generator circuit breaker doesn't come into the picture at all, because mainly your line closing will be done by the breaker which are on the other side of the bus. So this application of a generator circuit breaker doesn't go anything with a line side application. It's mainly go with application of generator and between the generator and generator transformer, not on the line side. And there is also from Mr. Rao, there are GCBs in NTPC coal dam. Yes, NTPC coal dam is having a GCB, and in hydropower plant 250 megawatt. Yes, sir, you are absolutely right. NTPC have already put GCB in one of the hydropower plant what they have constructed. You are absolutely right, sir. Yes, any more question? Otherwise, I am sharing my email ID in the chat. If anyone is interested in any specific topic with respect to their organization, or if you wanted to conduct any separate seminar presentation, we can be in touch with you. This is my email ID, and this is my WhatsApp number I am giving right now. This is my WhatsApp number. I'm sorry, I missed 10. This is the correct number, the second one. Yes, any more question, or we can make a closing note? Yeah, Manisha ma'am.
I don't see question in chat. Manas sir, do you have anything to add?
Yeah, I just wanted to ask one more question regarding nuclear power plant. Do they go for GCB or not?
Yes, in India, I have seen a nuclear power plant with the GCB.
In India?
Yes, sir. Yes.
Because recently we have gone for 1000 megawatt unit, the largest unit in India so far. So do they have GCB or they have this conventional one, what you are?
Sir, if you are talking about the recently tendered RAPP power plant, what I came to know from BHEL and L&T, who are the EPC for this project, that there were GCB requested in the specification. But I don't know about this 1000, whether it's 1000 megawatt or 800 megawatt, because I was not much involved. But what I know, yes, the few power plants, nuclear power plants in India, they have a GCB.
This application of GCB, does it depend upon the type of generation, or it has nothing to do with the type of generation?
Sir, it has nothing to do with the type of generation or a type of power plant, I would put in this way. Because generator is a generator, whether it's a hydro or a steam or a nuclear, whenever you have a generator, you have a generator circuit breaker.
No, because type of operation, type of this duty, they have different. That's what I'm asking. You have to specify differently for different type of application, or it is same for all?
No, it goes like this, sir. Let's say whenever you have a new power plant, let's say for example, NTPC is going for a new power plant of 660 megawatt machine. So based on their generator and their generator transformer, we can perform a study based on their generator technical data, on transformer data, that what is the fault current coming from system and what is the fault current coming from generator. And based on that fault current, we select a type of GCB, that which type of GCB goes into this application, because GCB is also having a various let's say range of the GCB, starting from let's say 50 kilo ampere till 300 kilo ampere. So based on that, we select a generator circuit breaker for given power plant. For example, if machine is of BHEL, but tomorrow if somebody else is supplying that generator, the entire fault calculation may also get changed, because fault calculation, it depends upon the impedance of that machine and also time constant of that machine. What we can do, sir, I can organize a dedicated training session if you required on fault current calculation also, which having more technical deliberation on this fault current and a duty with the CA, we can do that also if you want, sir, separately.
Okay.
This is very interesting topic. You would be more excited, or maybe we'll have a good technical dialogues during that, sir.
Yeah, actually, people are not aware of this type of GCV advantage. I think that's why people are hesitant to go for GCV. Maybe one of the reasons, the economic and cost, that is one aspect. But the benefit what we are getting, people are not fully convinced, I think. That may be the reason, because otherwise, we can have in the NTPC thermal power plant, we find they have to go for unit auxiliary transformer. If it is a 765 kV station, then they have to step down it to 132 kV. Then it has to be stepped down to get the unit auxiliary supply.
Exactly, sir.
Sir, if they go for GCV, I think a lot of things can be resolved easily. I think there must be some marketing or the strategy, or you have to convince them.
It's all about the guideline, I will put in this way. If there is a like, you know, I will put in this way. When I started my job as a designer in a substation, I look at the CBIP manual. And I will say, always first come is a surge arrester. Why you say, right, there is a surge arrester? Because you have to protect the substation from a surges coming from a line. So there is a guideline which is defined that, okay, you have a surge arrester, then why you have an isolator behind the isolator on the breaker side. So there is a guideline defined. So if such kind of guideline is also coming, to me, the use of the GCB, whenever I make such kind of technical dialogues with most of the users, they say, oh, if there is a guideline, we will do it. If there is a such guideline, we will do it. So I would recommend, I would put in this way, sir, the like you, the CA kind of organization or CBIP kind of organization, they also come up with some kind of joint dialogue with the users. And they say, yeah, this is a regulation or this is an amended guideline. Then this advantage, whatever we are talking about, directly goes into the project. Because everyone is saying, oh, it would be difficult. We have not used so far. How we should use it? There has to be some written guideline. Some came from the authority here and there. Then we can do it. So this is the topic we are always hearing from most of the users when we share the dialogue. Somebody also wanted to discuss their failure. And such dialogues always come upon that. If CA tell us, if CBIP tell us, we might do it.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you so much for your valuable inputs.
Thank you, sir. There is also a question from what are the typical voltage levels used in generation in India? I would say maybe starting from 11 kV even till 30 kV it can go. Maybe nuclear power plant also are with 30 kV also. Which circuit breaker have heavier breaking duty, GCB or HV circuit breaker? Of course GCB, no doubt. High voltage breaker, I have not seen high voltage breaker even over 100 kilo ampere, and GCBs are with 200 kilo ampere also. Can I have a copy of a presentation slide? I think you can coordinate with CBIP. CBIP will support you because CBIP is organizer of this training module. What is the preferred time constant for GCB? There is no preferred time constant. As I said, this kind of calculation goes project to project. So based on the project study, this calculation would require to be done. And this calculation is based on the generator data and generator transformer details. Yeah, can we summarize as a Can we summarize as the major difference between GCB and normal circuit breaker? GCB is faster breaker to open a fault. I would not say faster, because it's what is a faster? That's also definition. So one has to compare opening time of the GCB and opening type of that particular breaker. So this statement is a very wide open statement. I cannot conclude on the number one. GCB handles higher percentage of DC component while opening a fault. 200% correct. GCB can handle more DC component than HV circuit breaker for sure. GCB needs higher RRRV, or I will put in this way, GCB can clear higher TIRV faults. Out of phase current will be higher. I would put in this way, out of phase current with a delayed current zero would require a detailed investigation whether HV breaker can clear that or not, and higher fault breaking capacity for sure. GCB is having a higher fault breaking capability than that of HV circuit breaker.
Taken a lot of questions you have already handled, and I'm very happy what you did very intelligently or smartly. You kept the lesser time for presenting yourself, and you gave more time for taking the questions, because the subject is such where unless we handle the questions, the session will not be fruitful. And I could see why you have done it. I was really worried when you were telling me earlier that you will take less time for presenting and you give so much time for questions. But I think you were right. As a specialist, you knew what happens in the market and what kind of question you will be getting. So excellent way you have explained the basics of GCB, and even considering the comparison with HV, comparison of a short circuit, the out of phase situation we get into, the synchronization and so on. So I hope that we have triggered a lot of curiosity with respect to GCB in the market, and we will definitely come up together again with the CVIP, CEA, SIGRE to really take more technical insight, because GCB, each topic that Ketan was taking, each subtopic probably needs 2 hours or 3 hours deliberation. So definitely in coming days, we will be planning a more detailed session covering each and every aspect of it. I also take input from Mohapatra sir to work a bit on how to generate value or value creation if we have GCB, not only technical but also from economical point of view. So Ketan, let us work on that and then revert back to CIP and Mohapatra sir and see how do we take it forward in the market, because lot of customers may not be really aware of the advantages. Let me also put at this point, in our training center at PowerTech, we have full-fledged working GCB available. Unfortunately, we are doing this training due to pandemic. We are doing it online. I am sure in coming days when the situation is better, it's going to be with the vaccine which has already come. Once we plan face-to-face training, you all will be able to participate in face-to-face training at our state-of-the-art training center, PowerTech, where we will be able to see the GCB operation, and what is done there is the GCB is available with the transparent cover. So you will be able to see the entire GCB construction in and out along with the operation, close and open operation. So training or no training, I invite all of you to PowerTech whenever you are in Vadodara. Please just give a call to me or Ketan and we will be very happy to show you the entire GCB, its operation and anything else that you are interested in. And over to you, Manas sir. Please take the stage from me.
Yeah, thanks ma'am and your team, including all the participants. It's really a wonderful session this time, and I expect all the participants really enjoyed this session. Many kind of questions and answer I am just listening, sitting here from Gurgaon, and I hope ma'am from Baroda and his teams and all the faculties and participants from different parts of the countries and the globes. So it's a really wonderful moment for CBIP, ABB, Society of Power Engineers, and I expect people should enjoy in the same manner, similar manner in upcoming days also. Many kind of technical challenges we have, and if we discuss, if we participate, and I hope it's a one-way solutions. Correct? So all the best participants, once again, I am thanking to your valuable timings, your participations with CBIP, with ABB, Hitachi, as a partners, including SPE, and please carry on the same spirit. Thank you, sir. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. and I hope we will connect again on the same topic. Because
thank you so much once again. So please maintain your spirit in the same way, and many kind of organizations, I mean events. Okay, so we can we are ready to deliver with the best efforts, joint efforts.
Sure, sir. I'll be in touch with you for further actions that we can take. Mohapatra sir was suggesting some other parties.
Thank you, Mohapatra sir. Thank you, Rajput sir.
Thank you so much.
Yeah, thank you so much for your wonderful moments and sparing these important times. Really makes
sense.
Thank
you, everybody. Thank you.
Okay.